Okay, just call this a special edition of Leadership Perspectives. Our own Jerry Hayes is retiring. This interview just a couple of days before he is officially retired from your longtime anchor job at News 19.
Yeah.
You've been here 45 years.
It'll be 45 years on March 26th.
And in the building, I'm the only person who can say they were here when you got here.
That's true.
So
that's
true. Let's just begin.
I have stood on the shoulders of a giant all these years.
Well, we'll talk a little bit about us anchoring together, but let's start at the beginning. When you came here, did you have any idea that you would be here this long?
No, I didn't. And I don't think most people that are in this business, and I think you're probably in the same category as me, when you start this journey as a news person or a sports person, back then we had dreams of moving up to larger markets and making more money. But then all of a sudden...
Oh, I still have that dream.
Yeah, we all do still, don't we? But you know, at some point you get to a point where you say, you know, I'm comfortable.
Yeah.
I like it here. This is becoming home.
Yeah.
And, you know, then the money doesn't matter as much. As long as you're happy and the company's happy with the job you're doing, then, you know, it usually works out. So, yeah, I mean, I had an opportunity to leave several times. I got several calls from Knoxville. I even interviewed in Memphis at our sister station up there. At Mississippi, there was a station up in Maryland that called and wanted to talk to me. But, you know, you just get to a point in your career where you go, I like it here, and this is home.
Totally get it. You put down roots. Of course, you and I anchored together some when you first started. I was doing sports, and we were on the desk together.
We were, and we had some good times, except you usually zinged me at the end of sports
in one way or another. Because, Jerry, you were a natural-born straight man.
I know.
And we got letters back in, I'd have to think what it would be with social media, but we got letters saying, tell Steve Johnson, quit being so mean to Jerry Hayes.
I remember that. Yeah, and it was all in good fun because you and I have been friends for 45 years. And, you know, it was just our way of just kind of ribbing each other and having a good time. But, yeah, some of the viewers were like, man, came to my defense. And I played it that way, too.
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, Steve, I'm going to let you get a jab in, but we'll hear about it from somebody.
Okay, so you and I anchored together, but you probably have lost count at this point about how many other people you have anchored with. And I'm talking about, sports people for sure, but I'm talking about co-anchors. Do you even remember how many?
Well, I've been trying to go back. It's been more than a dozen. You know, when I started here, Cherie Blakemore was doing weekends.
Yeah.
And so I reported for a week or two, and they put me with Cherie on the weekends. And from there, I mean, the list just kept going because I kept moving to different positions. But Missy Ming was the first one that I anchored with on either the 6 or 10, Monday through Friday.
And Missy, of course, I don't think we need to get this in there. Missy was the first woman full-time anchor in the city of Huntsville, the Huntsville TV market, I believe.
I think she was the first female anchor to anchor full-time in the state of Alabama.
Oh, wow.
So
I didn't realize that, but I know she was the first.
Yeah,
And a great reporter, too.
Yeah.
And that's okay. So you've been an anchor, but you also have reported over the years. In fact, there were times when you were doing more reporting than anchoring.
Yeah, there was a time where I think I went to the news director and said, you know, I really miss reporting.
Yeah.
And so I went to them and said, is there any way I can you know, maybe get off the 10 o'clock? And they put Jamie Tucker on there, who now is doing What the Tech for several stations around the country. And Jamie co-anchored 10, and that allowed me to come in earlier in the day and report, which I loved. But then there were a lot of times where, you know, we'd have a live report at 5 o'clock, and I'd have to bust it to get back here to the station.
Yeah.
And usually I was with Greg Stone, our chief videographer. And Greg and I would run out of the newsroom at 4:45 to make it to our live shot at 5 o'clock. And it was, finally, I looked at the assignment editor and told him, I said, you guys are killing us, because they wanted that fronted live shot at 5 o'clock, but then you had to be back here at 6. So you couldn't go much further than Athens back then because you had to be able to do your live shot and then get back here.
Okay, this just occurred to me. been a lot of changes since we started. I think the year you came to 19 is when we switched from film. Yes, yeah. We actually used film for a time.
16-millimeter film.
We went from film to the first videotape.
Yeah.
And that was certainly a change in the business.
Yeah, it was. And, of course, you know, back then when the station signed on the air in 63, they shot 16-millimeter film with audio carts. It looked like old 8-tracks.
Yeah.
And if you don't know what an 8-track tape is, Google it. You know, you'll figure it out. Yeah. But we would cut our audio on that, as you know, and then those would air. Well, there's no way to archive that.
No.
So we've still got some film from back then, but from 63 to
79 is when we
August
made
of 79,
the switch, yeah.
That's when we went to what we call electronic news gathering, or ENG.
Yeah.
And it was 3/4-inch videotape. A lot wider than the VHS tapes that people used later on.
And we did different modes of taping for several years, and now we're non-linear. It's like
Everything goes on a little computer.
It could be
card.
On your phone. That's the way it is.
Yeah, and we shoot stories on our phones.
Yes. I mean, it is a different world. In fact, let's talk about some other changes that just strike you over the course of your career, things that have changed that stand out.
Well, I mean, one thing is being able to go live from the scene of somewhere. You know, when we first got our first live van, which was, I think, in 1980 or 81, we were still on the mountain, and it allowed us to be able to go live from just about anywhere. But back then, you had a tower that you raised on the live van. You had a microwave that had to be able to see the dish, which was on top of the top of the tower on top of Montesano. So you had line of sight. If you couldn't see that, if there was a mountain or something in your way, you'd have to go somewhere else.
Well, and a famous case of that, and I don't know if you ever had this, but when Toyota first built their factory, you could get live shots out of there, but the trees grew up in the little dip in the mountain, and eventually you couldn't get live shots from the Toyota plant.
Yeah.
Which was strange.
So we went from microwave live shots to then a satellite truck, which meant you could send your signal up and back to a receiver here at the station. You could pretty much go live from anywhere in the country at that point. And, of course, now the photographers wear little backpacks or they hang it on their tripod and an MMJ.
Yeah. Multimedia journalist.
Multimedia
which
journalist.
Is what we call reporters now.
Can just go live by themselves.
Yeah, it's essentially a phone call.
Right, it is.
It's a phone call.
Or you can go live on your iPhone.
Yeah. But and you don't really see. I mean, you have to maybe. I'm not sure when you'd have to, but we have a satellite truck, but we don't use it very much anymore. And we used to use it. I mean, it has driven to Kennedy Space Center more than once.
Yeah.
In fact, you and I co-anchored some shuttle coverage. I think it was Return to Flight.
It was a Return to Flight, and I will never forget that because you and Greg Stone were already there at Kennedy Space Center. I flew down, and we did some team coverage there that night, got ready for the launch the next day, and it was the first flight that I had been to. That was going to be my first launch.
I think I know what probably happened.
And it scrubbed.
Yeah.
And so I thought, well, they're just going to leave the two of us here for a day or two till they reschedule. And the news director called and said, go ahead. We're going to get you back on the plane to come back to Huntsville.
Yeah.
And I went, no. You know, I so wanted to see a shuttle launch live.
I'm thinking that the Return to Flight, this was after the Columbia disaster.
Yeah,
that's the
it
one,
was.
That's the one that they tried for 2 weeks and then stopped and had to, and then it was like a month before the original launch date, before they got it up.
Yeah.
Okay, so that was a really fun story, and I think you would probably, just the going down there and covering shuttle flights is a highlight, and you have covered shuttle flights. What are some highlights when you look back on your career? Stories where you thought, man, I was there, and it was just cool.
Well, I mean, one of the biggest was Barack Obama's inauguration. Yeah. And also being at the White House in 1986, I believe it was. Bill Clinton was still president. And got to sit in the Roosevelt Room during a news conference with him and ask him about workers at the Marshall Space Flight Center.
Yeah.
And So yeah, those were probably two of the biggest highlights and of my career. But just being there, having a front row seat to history like that.
Yeah.
What people don't realize that when we went to Washington to cover the inauguration of Barack Obama, it was myself and Shane Hayes, yeah. another photojournalist, and we slept on cots in offices in a building right across the street from the Ford Theater. We didn't have a hotel room.
Well, no, there were a few people there.
We were the people that owned the company at the time, Tribune. They had a bureau there.
Yeah.
We worked out of their bureau up on, I think, the 7th or 8th floor. We would go to the rooftop to do our live shots for the 6 and 10 o'clock news that night. And, but we weren't, people think, oh, it's got to be exciting. No, you're constantly working. You don't have time to see the sights or do anything.
Yeah, you don't. Yeah,
you don't. Because you got to have a story for 6 and front it. Yeah. You got to have a story for 10 and front it. Then they want something for the morning broadcast.
Yeah.
So it's nonstop. But those two trips to Washington were probably one of the biggest things I enjoyed most.
I know you consider another highlight. You covered Alabama before, and they were Alabama.
Yeah.
Talking about the music group.
Yeah, they were Alabama when I first met them.
But they weren't Alabama.
Yeah, they were starting out their careers. They had just recorded their first album. And one of my coworkers here, we were doing a week-long series on country music. And she said, well, there are these guys from Fort Payne, and they've just released their album on RCA, and said, you know, maybe you can call over to Fort Payne and hook up with them and make them part of your series on country music. And I thought, yeah, it'd be great, local guys. So I struck up a conversation with their road manager, Bruce Burnett at the time. And he said, hey, we're going to be at the Gaslight Theater at Opryland on a Sunday.
Yeah.
So said, come on up, you can get your video and stuff. So I drove up to Nashville, couldn't get a photographer to work with me that weekend because it was a weekend. And so I went up and shot it myself, carried my twin brother with me to carry the backpack, which was the 3/4 inch.
And we're talking twins.
yeah. And so Terry was my grip that day.
That's pretty cool.
But interviewed Randy backstage and of course got all the video we needed. And to this day, Randy still says that I was the first television reporter to ever do a story on him.
Yeah, and you've covered him, so many times. Now, to me, and I want to see if it's you're the same. Really, when I look back on my career here, it's the friends I've made with people I've done stories with, with media people I've worked with people who worked here. And we've seen a lot of people with bosses we've had. We've seen a lot of them, too.
Oh, yeah.
Is that what jumps out at you when you think about your 45 years at Channel 19, the friends?
Yeah, and I've met a lot of people, as you know, on your journey. You meet a lot of people along the way, and somehow you make a connection one way or the other. And you become friends, and a lot of those friends I've stayed in touch with over the years. And the boys in the band over in Fort Payne, Jeff, Randy, Teddy, all of them.
You're one of the few immediate people who just call them up.
Yeah, and I'll be sitting on the set occasionally. I'll get a text from Randy.
Yeah.
You know,
nobody famous text me, so I don't have that.
Oh, I doubt that. I bet if we looked at your phone, we'd find somebody famous in there.
Okay, so they're giving me time cues. It's normal, we normally take a certain amount of time. But I want to ask you, when you think about working here for as long as you've worked here, what is something that you want to make sure the people watching this right now know? And I'm not sure where I want you to go with this. It's where you want to go with it. Because it's been a journey.
I mean,
it's been 45 years of doing television coverage, which we're not putting shingles on roofs. Nobody should ever think we're working like that.
No,
we're not. We're doing a job that many people would say, well, that's pretty cushy. You get to be on television.
Yeah.
But what do you want people to know?
I want people to know that we are working all day long. You may see us on camera for 30 minutes or an hour when we're sitting here anchoring, but we have been working all day to check out the facts of the story to make sure that what we're saying is factual, that it's the latest information.
Yeah.
We have a series of checks and balances We work closely with the reporters on their stories. And I just hope that when I walk away from the anchor desk and am no longer reporting, that people will just look at me and say, you know what? Jerry did a good job. I felt like I was having a conversation with him, and he wasn't just reading the news to me. And he was fair.
Okay. All right. That's professional, Jerry. What do you want people to remember about Jerry?
That he loved doing what he did.
That makes it sound like you're gone. But
retiring. And I'm not leaving. I mean, I'm going to stay in Huntsville. I just hope people know that I enjoyed doing what I did. I loved my job, and that's the reason I've stayed here for so long. You know, I thought about retiring last year, and my daughters said, no, Dad, go another year. And I think they were worried because they knew I didn't have anything lined up to do, you know, or what's Dad going to do once he retires. But I think you get a point in your career and in your life where you go, you know, 45 years, 4 days later, on March 30th, I'll turn 70. That's long enough. I mean, I could go another year or two.
Yeah.
But why? You know, I mean, it's going to be the same day in, day out. There's a lot of stress with this job. And I think that people don't realize that. And the business has changed to the point where you still get a lot of compliments on the work that you do, but when you do something that people don't agree with, you hear from that too.
Yeah.
So I think it's at a point where it's like, you know what, I just need to step away. This is a good time. 45 years and turning 70, you know, it's time to start a new journey and start enjoying life and slow down a little bit and spend more time with the family and the grandkids.
All right, Jerry. Thank you, buddy.
I've enjoyed working with you all these years, too.
And of course, we have each other's phone number.
So, see, you do have somebody famous in your phone list.
Please text me when I'm on the air.
I will.
All right, man. Thank you,
buddy.